This is just a sound check, right?
Yeah.
All right. Hi, I'm Jim Fergus.
Okay.
When did you start writing? Do you remember, what's your earliest memories of writing, and why did you start writing novels?
Well, I started writing when I was sort of early adolescence, 12, 13, sometime in there. And I'd always sort of wanted to be a novelist, but I got, I was writing sort of, obviously at that time in my life, juvenilia. And I think I, partly was, I had kind of a difficult, dysfunctional family situation, and my mother was a very bad alcoholic, and both my parents died when I was 16, so I think that writing was a sort of a refuge for me at that age, 12, 13, and dealing with some of the, terrors of living in a, alcoholic family and and such. So I think that was sort of one of the prime. And, so it was mostly journal.
Something
journal
share,
kind of,
by
kind
the
of
way.
Writing. Yeah, is that right? Yeah. Yeah, interesting.
So have you, do you still keep journals?
I keep notebooks. Just those little pocket reporter notebooks that I usually carry around in my top pocket. And I used to be, when I did a lot of journalism, which I don't do anymore at all. I mean, I barely do. I used to do a lot of sporting things, bird hunting and fishing and I always carried one of those around or I did interviews and literary, I did some work, I did an interview years ago. I don't know if you ever read with Jim Harrison in the Paris Review.
Yeah.
I used to do profiles of actors and movie people, and I did a piece on The River Runs Through It. And in those days, I was kind of a relentless note taker because of that was my job.
Yeah.
I find that my notebooks now are mostly filled up with grocery lists these days. they're much less. I look at my old notebooks and they're sort of interesting. My new ones are like watching paint dry. They're just unbelievably boring. And I guess they reflect my interest in food. But
did you write in high school, like on the newspaper?
I really didn't, George. I was, an English major in college. In high school, I had an English teacher. I went to a boarding school in Massachusetts, my parents died when I was a sophomore there. And I had, there was one English teacher in particular there, a guy named Tom Chaffee, who was very sort of dour and unhappy fellow, but brilliant. And he had a reputation as being, everybody was terrified of him.
Yeah.
And, he was very, very strict, and it was back in the day, and he had a rule, the school had a rule, but he was the enforcer of it, where you couldn't have sideburns any longer than mid-ear.
Even hair. We're talking sideburns.
Yeah, I can remember being sent back to my room by Tom Chaffee one day because, I was an eighth of an inch longer. He was this kind of guy. But he was a brilliant, brilliant guy and a great reader and a very demanding teacher. And I think it was in my senior year, I got 100 on a paper, that 100% on a essay that I'd written for his class, and it was sort of like wildfire went through the school that Fergus had gotten 100 from Tom Chaffee, because I don't know that he'd ever given 100 before. I was asked about it at hockey practice. My hockey coach even asked me, he said, I understand you got 100 from Chaffee.
Jeez.
And it was a great incentive for me to become a writer. That was even further incentive. I was really, that remains one of, I'm as proud of that 100 I got from Tom Chaffee as I am of any of the books I've ever written. That was a big deal for me.
Have you stayed in touch? I mean, is the guy still alive? Or?
No, he's dead. I sent him my first book, A Hunter's Road.
Oh, neat.
I'm sorry that he died before I published a novel. And I sent him that, and I got a very gracious letter back from him saying that he was proud of me, so that was kind of rewarding. Yeah.
Okay, so the first byline you remember?
The first byline?
Yeah.
Gosh, what would that have been?
Nothing stands out?
Well, I can remember. I quit. I was a tennis pro for 10 years, between 20 and 30. And I had tried to, you know, when I got out of college as an English major, I, you know, had these dreams of becoming a, you know, famous novelist, and, as many of us do. And,
right.
And you know, it, and I, you know, wrote my little short stories and shipped them off to you know, all the different literary magazines and the New Yorker and everywhere. And of course, none of them were accepted. And it occurred to me fairly quickly that I was not going to be able to make a living doing this, you know. So I started teaching tennis, and I worked in Colorado, and then I moved down to Florida and taught down there for a while. And I really effectively kind of stopped writing. I still kept up journal writing, but I really, for those 10 years, I was not very productive as a writer. And I think my first piece, my first byline was an article about tennis for some little remote publication in Denver.
Yeah.
I quit teaching. I saved up $8,000 in teaching tennis. And in 1980, I moved back to Colorado from Florida and started writing full time. I rented a little cabin in northern Colorado for $75 a month, and you know, it had an old, you know, hand pump on the back porch and an old coal stoker, and you know the drill. And but it was cheap living, and it was a tiny little town. That was and I started just writing for regional local newspapers and magazines in Denver, and you know, I made $10,000 a year as a writer, that was a lot of money.
Any particular writers that, as you were, and during that period, that you were sort of obsessing on or watching, reading?
Or books?
Writers or books?
Well, you know, I had always, I went through a period, I think a lot of us did back then, I loved J.P. Donlevy novels. You know, I liked that whole picaresque thing, and you know, because they were great young men's books,
because
they reflected so much of what you know, what was going on with us. And and then I loved all the classics. I read the Russians and the French. I always loved French, certain French literature.
Yeah.
And I've just come back to some of that, you know. I reread Flaubert, Madame Bovary, which I liked very much and still do. And it's interesting to read something that you read, you know, 30, 40 years ago. And as a so-called grown up, you know, and a little bit more educated, and it's a new experience.
In those periods, I used to underline everything. And now when I go back and look, I go, what the hell was I thinking there?
You know? Yeah, I know. It's not funny. I did the same thing, George. My books were in, I didn't have much room in my little cabin. I had a lot of my books from my college days and before even. They were still in storage, you know, these little Signet paperbacks that were all dog-eared, that, you know, would cost $1.50, and I had the same thing. They were all underlined. You know? I was amused by that, because I barely remember doing that. I was reading Tom McGuane, at that, you know, 92 in the Shade, the Sporting Club and
Missouri Breaks,
and the Missouri Breaks, and. You know, through McGuane, I had discovered Harrison too, and although I didn't actually meet Jim until, well, I guess I met him in 1979, I think.
Oh, that early.
Yeah. I've known Jim for a long time. It was right at the beginning. I'd gone off to the Caribbean with my $8,000 to write my first novel, my first of several unpublishable novels. You know,
I went to Greece and I wrote The Great American Paragraph.
Yeah, that sort of thing. And I got, you know, I mean, I got a late start. As a novelist, I didn't publish 1,000 White Women until, gosh, I was in my, I was almost 50.
What led you to writing 1,000 White Women? I mean, that's a dumb question. I apologize for it, but it's sort of, you've raised the topic here of how you went from these short writing pieces to suddenly launching into such a significant book.
Yeah, I had I was getting a little bit nervous as I hit my, you know, mid-40s, and I had not written a novel, not published a novel, and the sort of the difficulty of being, I was a freelance writer, and I was became rather successful at it. As freelance writing goes, it was a modest living, but right. I remember 1 year I made, and this would have been back in the 80s, I made $60,000 as a freelance writer. Oh. I thought that was a bloody fortune.
Yeah.
The problem with that was, is I had to, in order to make a modest living at it year after year, I was either writing pieces or hustling or, writing, query letters and trying to drum up business and going to New York and meeting with editors. And I just didn't have time. I mean, that's not an excuse, I suppose, also. But I never had time to be. I'm not good at multitasking. I have to sort of do one thing at a time. And so I had set out, I wrote A Hunter's Road first. And that was a nonfiction book about traveling around the United States with my old yellow lab for 5 months and upland bird hunting. Which is still, I have to say, it's still my favorite of my books. Yeah. It has a special place in my heart, that book. Unbelievably concise journals every day at the end of the day, because I knew I was covering so much ground. I hunted in 23 states and 21 different species of upland birds, but it's not a how-to hunting book at all. It's more of just a travel road book and sort of that genre, the American road book genre. And I hunted with Jim Harrison in it, and Richard Ford, and various other people, and
with these guys.
This was long before that. Yeah. This was in back. I published it in 1991, fall of. Right. I think it was the fall of 91. And so I had these journals that I kept in for 5 months. And when I got home in February to Northern Colorado, my little cabin, which I ended up had purchased by this time for $28,000, I sat down, just took a week off to kind of get settled back in after my trip. I hunted, this was my last stop in Patagonia, Arizona, in that season, that bird season, and then I went back to Colorado, and I started writing, and the book just wrote itself. I had my journals open, and it was the purest writing experience I've ever had, I kept up with magazine work. After that, I started getting a lot of assignments with the sporting magazines, Field and Stream, and I did a column for Outdoor Life for 3 years, and a column for Sports Afield for 3 years, and a bunch of feature work for them. And I really didn't have time for fiction. And as I say, around mid-40s, I was casting about for another book idea after Hunter's Road, and I came across this. The story about the Northern Cheyennes and Little Wolf, what I originally set out to do was I was going to write a nonfiction sort of biography of Little Wolf, who I consider to be one of the great Indian chiefs, and very compared to Chief Joseph or Sitting Bull or Crazy Horse, was really not much had been written about him. Mm-hmm. And I got interested in him, and I started researching what I thought was going to be this nonfiction book, and then I came across this little. This request that the Cheyennes had made at this peace conference in 1854 for the gift of 1,000 white women. And I was just fascinated by the idea, and I thought it would be an interesting jumping off point for a novel. And so I abandoned the nonfiction book and set out to write a novel. It was sort of my premise, and how this could actually have worked,
The obvious question, one of the things we're after is technology. That your first book, The Hunter's Road, no doubt was done pen and paper.
Yeah, the whole thing was still, I still can't believe that I used to write everything that way. I used to write, I had a typewriter. Yeah. I was sort of self-taught to type. But I did a lot of handwriting still. And now it seems inconceivable to me.
Doesn't it?
Yeah. I don't know how, because I mean, one thing about the computers, it's both good and bad. It can encourage a lot of gratuitous tinkering, cutting and pasting, and which if you had to write the whole page over again, you wouldn't bother with.
Now you work off a computer.
Yeah, I strictly work with the computer now, and I still. if I travel and or I'm on an airplane, and I will still handwrite, and I still carry my notebooks around, yeah. And larger notebooks when I'm traveling, and I'll still take notes on things. I'll handwrite that. But when it comes time to sit down, I mean, I don't know how Jim still does it. You know that he still does everything by longhand, which yeah. I really admire. And I look at his manuscripts, and they're always so clean. Yeah. You know, he just doesn't even do much revision.
So when you write, do you write every day?
Well, if I'm writing fiction, I try to write every day. You know, I remember talking to Tom McGuane about this years ago when I was interviewing him, and he likened the writing process to when you build a campfire. You know, you lay your paper and your kindling, and you get it burning. And if you let it go out, you got to start all over again, right? And it's really true, you know. Nice. with fiction, you know, you take, I mean, every now and then you have to take a little bit of a break from things. But when I like to work, if I'm in the middle of an hour, I like to work 7 days a week. I don't like to take any time off, and I'm exceptionally dull spouse, although I'm not married now, possibly, why? You know, it's just, you know, it's not fun. You're not good company for anybody, particularly when you live like that. But I really, you know, find that to be true.
Have you ever taught a class or workshop to writers, prospective writers, hopeful writers, students?
No, I've never done any teaching. I've never taken a class. I don't think I'd be very good at it. I don't think I know enough about it yet. to think about teaching. You know, you have this illusion. I thought after I wrote 1,000 White Women, I thought, good, I finally have written a novel, and now the next one is going to be so much easier. And it isn't at all. It's so discouraging. You find out that it's like starting all over again every time.
Every writer has said that.
It's
more difficult.
Yeah, it is. In fact, if anything, it does get more difficult. I mean, I have to say, I hate writing fiction. When I sit down to work, sometimes I'm in the middle of a novel. I wake up with just, you know, a pit in my stomach. I feel like I'm going to puke, and it's, you know, it's very, very difficult and painful for me. And I've never been able to recreate that experience I had with A Hunter's Road in fiction. Yeah. You know, it's my ideal, but I know now that I never will. My advice is to have a backup profession. Really.
You mentioned that.
Yeah, I bet. I mean, no, truly, you know, I mean, I feel unbelievably lucky to be able to make a modest living as a writer, and have been for, you know, 30 years. And I am really, I'm proud of that. I'm also grateful. I mean, I think I feel mostly lucky, you know, I feel just really lucky, but it's such a difficult profession. And I think it's more and more, I don't think I could have done it in this era. When I look back, and you know, the way that I was able to live in northern Colorado so cheaply, and with my little $8,000, you know, grub steak, and there were markets then. You know, there were much more robust freelance markets. Yeah. In 1980, 1990, and those have largely evaporated now. I mean, I don't know how a young man goes about getting a foothold in the business any longer. I guess online, and you know, if they want to freelance, you know, that has nothing to do with writing fiction, of course. But I mean, and there's a reason that so many novelists and poets teach.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, that's their backup profession. You know, they have to make a living, and they need to have some free time to write. It's kind of the best of both worlds.
One of the things we've been interested in also is that, it's my suspicion, and you've got a great insight on this, how writers are treated here in America versus other places such as France. And I'm familiar with, for example, Japan, where, you know, writers and artists can be considered like national resources like parks.
Yeah, that's an interesting thing. You know, I do spend a lot of time in France because I publish quite successfully over there. I mean, 1,000 White Women was sold 400,000 copies in France, and is still considered one of the biggest successes of the last decade. I mean, it was huge, and you know, the first printing was 6,000 copies, and then it just sort of took off. And you know, I went over there the first time. I hadn't been to my mother was French, but I wasn't sadly brought up bilingually, but I learned it in some French in school, and I went over there for the first time. I hadn't been to France in 20 some years, and I went over with Jim Harrison for the publication of 1,000 White Women, and we did this live television show together, and you know, it was like a variety, it's sort of the French equivalent. It was the largest viewership show on television, and it was kind of the French equivalent of the Tonight Show, that sort of thing. And you know, I had just come from Rand, little Jimmy Fergus from Rand, Colorado, population 13, you know. and about 2 days after we get to Paris, you know, we're still jet lagged, and I went on this show with Harrison, and we went into the, you know, backstage in the makeup room, and they put makeup on. Of course, I was absolutely terrified.
Yeah, of course.
And Harrison went out first, and they had this goofy host, and the French were sitting, they had a sort of amphitheater where the audience was sitting, and I was standing behind the curtain, and Jim was telling some anecdote about how we'd met or some, and you know, when I was a tennis pro, and it involved a woman, of course, with Jim.
Right.
And then all of a sudden the curtain parts, and the orchestra starts playing this hokey French music, and they've got this guy directing the audience, and the audience is all swinging back and forth in their seats like this, and they say Jim Fergus, you know, and I was just like a deer in the headlights. I was so terrified, and you know, I had to go out there and sit, you know, and we had those little you know, like instant translation, like at the UN.
Oh, yeah.
You know, and it was very disconcerting because I understood enough French that it was, you know, and then I've got this guy, you know, translating my ears.
Double input.
And the whole thing. And at one point I looked over at Harrison because Harrison, you know, nothing fazes him. He was so relaxed. He just said, I looked over him for him, and I swear he was dozing off in his seat. You know?
Yeah.
You know, in France, yes, this is a long answer to a short question, but you know, if you're a writer, you're an important person. You're a big shot. You know, I walk down the street with Harrison, and it's like walking around with you know, Mick Jagger or something.
Yeah.
You know, people recognize him. They come up and say hello to him, introduce themselves. You go into a bar, and people. I mean, he's incredibly famous in France.
Yeah.
And you know, and since I've, you know, had that huge success, I've published a couple more books. I just published a book, a novel, in May, this last May, in France, that I haven't been able to sell to an American publisher. And it's a family historical fiction that involves my French mother and grandmother, and sort of spans the 20th century. It's a big doorstopper, and you know, France is, the language is 30% longer, so that, you know, everything is, I mean, it's a massive book. You know, I published it quite successfully. There was never, you know, when you have a success like 1,000 White Women, it's not something that you repeat usually on the next one or the one after that or ever, maybe, you know.
Yeah.
But, you know, it still did quite well. Yeah, I mean, culture, it's a whole different culture. Although, I have to say, I'm noticing they're having declining readership in France.
Really?
Book sales are down in France. And publishers are very nervous. They had last, when my book came out, they just had their worst, across the board in the industry, they had their worst first quarter ever. So, you know, things are changing there. So a lot of the magazines are going out of business. There are fewer, you know, there are fewer outlets. But, you know, as an example, I was putting together reviews for this last novel that I haven't even been able to sell in America. I got print reviews across France, 56 print reviews, magazines and newspapers, 56, and 26 radio or television spots, some of which I did. Wow. I did live, you know, television and live radio shows, and you know, I mean, that's just unheard of in America.
Yeah.
I mean, I've never, this is the first interview I think I've ever done in America.
Yeah, you know? Right?
Yeah, I never get interviewed here. I never get reviewed. I never get interviewed. You know, in the French, you know, I read these reviews and they refer to me as le grand écrivain américain, you know, the great American writer. Well, you know, that's, I mean, let's face it, that's bullshit. I'm not a great American writer, but it's nice to somebody thinks so,
yeah.
You know, and no, it's, I mean, it's a wonderful environment. And I talked to Phil when he got back, Caputo, about it, you know, and he was struck by the same thing. You know, all the journalists that interview you, with a very, very rare exception, have read your entire book.
They know it.
You know, they've and you can tell. You know, writers can always tell from the questions whether they've read your book or not. Yeah. And these guys, you know, they really do read the book and they ask intelligent questions. And that's a, you know, it's a reading culture. You can still go to the Luxembourg Gardens and, you know, you see, you know, young women sitting on a bench reading a novel on their lunch hour,
yeah.
You know,
yeah.
And they're, but you're also starting to see a lot of people, kids with their heads buried in their, you know, iPhones. Everybody has an iPhone in France now.
Yeah.
And, so, you know, that culture, I think, is sadly changed. A lot of those little independent bookshops that, we're all over Saint-Germain area, all over Paris, really. There, a lot of them are going out of business. Yeah. The same thing's happening there is happening in America. So, you know, it's unfortunate. But, yeah, so I would say that it's an utterly, utterly different culture. And I feel, you know, it's France is not a bad place to be famous either.
No.
You know, you eat well and you drink well. And,
yeah.
Yeah, it's
surrounded by beauty.
And yeah, really.
What about your research? Online, is it?
No, I love, that's my favorite part of writing. Still, I think because of my sort of background as a journalist. I mean, when I say my background as a journalist, it's sort of somewhat pretentious because I'm kind of a, what they would call a hook and bullet writer, you know? I mean, a real journalist is someone like Phil Caputo, you know?
Yeah.
And he's the real thing. So I'm really, you know, you know, and I think that's why all my novels are based on, I start with a kernel of, and it's my family novel, which is more of a, sort of a half, the one that I published in France is sort of a, you know, occupies some, no man, I think the reason I can't sell in America, I understand why I can't sell, it's a very difficult kind of book, because it occupies this no man's land between a memoir and fiction, and it's sort of neither one nor the other, and so it's, but anyway, it, you know, I did a huge amount of research for it, and as I do for all my books, and I always start out, The Wild Girl was the same thing, it was, you know, started out with a true story about this young Indian girl who was captured in the Sierra Madre by an American mountain lion hunter who was doing predator control hunting for ranchers down in Sonora. Yeah. And he captured this girl. She was considered one of the last of the Bronco Apaches. And this was in 1932. And I was so fascinated by this story, you know. And that became...
It's a touching scene as the photographer stands at the jail cell and looks at her on the floor.
Yeah.
It was very well written.
Yeah, that was, you know, so I don't think I'm comfortable just making up things out of whole cloth. You know, I like to start off with something, you know, kind of concrete. And I love, you know, I'm researching a new novel that I've sold. I sold the idea to my French publisher. Again, I don't have a deal with Americans on it, but, and it involves, this woman painter in the 1920s and 30s in Paris. It was sort of, disappeared and, it's a really fun project, and you know, it's like research to me is like detective work, you know. And I spent, you know, 3 days in the Bibliothèque Nationale in Paris, and which is magnificent. I'd like to live there. It's just unbelievable.
So I've seen it.
Yeah, I'd never seen it before, and it was just it's just astonishing. You know, this domed, huge 100-foot domed ceiling with, you know, glass, and you know, it's round, and there, you know, all these different levels with cover, obviously full of books, and then the long tables with the green glass lamps, right. And the scholars and the students were doing their work there. I just adored it.
And
I've got my little card in my wallet. I'm very proud of it. I show it to everybody with my photograph on it. Yeah. I love the whole process of researching. I have to force myself to stop researching and start writing, because you know, you end up not using 90% of the research you do anyway. But I feel you have to know it. Mm-hmm. You know, it has to be there. So that's the part that I like, and I'm really enjoying this novel that I'm working on now, this French novel, because I haven't started writing yet.
You know? There's been no pain yet.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it's just been fun so far.
Well, Jim, thanks ever so much for your time. And
well, thanks for this is, for being my first interview in America.
We are so proud. And didn't even have to speak French at any point throughout it.
I know, that was really good. That was the best part.